That is going to be, again, Geishas versus Sanctuary.
So Geishas on the left and Sanctuary on the right. Sanctuary will be getting the first ban. All right, who do you think will be the first ban? We have no idea
how these
teams play. Let's see. First ban. Let's go. The normal bans. Artanis, Ragnaros.
Ragnaros. We see an occasional Zarya ban on different regions. Even here as well. I think we saw it once.
Artanis,
but there you go.
Here we go.
You called it. Artanis ban.
Second ban, Ragnaros.
Ragnaros. ETC. Diablo sometimes. What else? You know what? I can actually see a first pick Malfurion, maybe.
All right, here we go. Ragnaros ban. All right, the normal two bans. Very, very safe bans.
Yeah, very popular. We also see Falstad being banned at times as well.
Zarya.
There we go. First pick Zarya.
All right.
Quite a popular pick recently, and based on the previous matches yesterday.
Very powerful utility hero, able to shield herself and her teammates, mitigating the damage and protecting important backliners, and also able to deal out the damage, not just someone who can soak up the damage, but also can retaliate and take out some enemy teams, enemy heroes herself.
And can also set up for some initiates and team fights if they want to with the Graviton Surge.
Yeah. Or with the Expulsion Zone, able to... Oh, here we go. Top tier healer on Geisha's side.
Gotta secure that Malfurion.
That's right. And Falstad. Okay, another strong global on Geisha's side, able to traverse around the map of Cursed Hollow to compete for the tributes.
Yeah, great call though. Let's see how they will respond. There are a couple of healers, but to be picked, one popular pick would be Rhaegar. We saw an Aurea, but only once yesterday.
Only once. You were sad that it was only once.
It was only once. And they lost. I think it was Renovasho that picked the Aurea.
Oh, but Brightwing.
They decided to get a Brightwing instead.
It's a really good healer.
Yes, and just as you mentioned, that Globals is pretty important when you are battling at the Cursed Hollow due to how large the map is. It is going to be understandable that you'd get a Brightwing. And we'll see though, what are their damage dealers going to be for the side? What else? I mean, Varian can go tank and go damage, but you know what? They already have that tanky Zarya.
Tychus ban, really interesting ban. Like I mentioned in the previous game, Tychus ban indicates that they are going for a tank heavy setup.
True.
Or even Cho'Gall.
Or even Cho'Gall.
If you're looking at a previous game.
Remember yesterday, people have been going for that triple tank setup.
That's right.
Despite Tychus being picked, it wasn't still as effective as expected due to the fact that he wasn't able to get the proper positioning that he desired to actually deal the damage to those three tanks. So but still though, giving it away out there, Tychus being banned, maybe you're right. Maybe they will probably get ETC. Oh, wow!
Oh, wow!
So
much
for saying!
Nice! ETC ban. Yep, definitely good ban. Tychus indicates that they are going for a tank-heavy setup. ETC retaliation ban would be a good choice here.
True, but Tehaka is, that means Tehaka is open, Diablo is open, Johanna, what else do they pick?
They will most likely go for either Diablo or Tehaka. Tehaka being a very strong global, it combines really well with Falstad. There was one team using Tehaka yesterday combined with Falstad on the top and bottom lane pressure. But Li Ming is a good ranged assassin as well.
Mm-hmm. With really, really bursty damage and great mobility just in case somebody gets too close.
Here we go, Diablo.
That's the Diablo pick. What else are they missing here on the red side? I think they do need some damage.
Assassins here. They might go for the Vala. They have pretty squishy backliners here. Malfurion, Falstad, and Li Ming. They could go for the Vala or the Zeratu here to try to take them out as fast as possible before Diablo responds with the Apocalypse.
Yes, sirree. So they're really... Geishas is really forming quite a scary match with Falstad and Li Ming in the backline. Might be quite problematic, especially if Brightwing can't heal as big if everybody else, you know, charges, focuses on one target. So
Assassin out with Jaina.
Jaina being picked. Probably just to...
And Zeratu. Here we go. Zeratu, important to take out Li Ming and Falstad. And you want to make sure that Li Ming doesn't go for the resets on her trait. So really important for that. Last pick, good flexibility here. They do have the tank and the assassin and the support. They can go for the dual support. They can go for the dual tank since there's already no Tigers, they have to find someone to protect the Li Ming from Zeratul. They could even go for Tacita here.
Yes.
To defend against the Zeratul.
That is true, especially when Diablo charges in or somebody else dies. But Dicterial instead, great utility, great mobility for the team if they want to reposition themselves. So, Sanctification.
Sanctification will be really important to protect Li Ming. Although it's going to be a bit interesting here, they do not have really powerful frontliners. They have Diablo as a CC-er and Tyrael to sort of defend against, defend for the Li Ming. But no strong frontliners here. They have to really protect the backlines from engages.
That is true. You think the Zeratul would go for the Void Prison and then like disrupt the frontline first, then go attack Void Prison the frontline, then go attack Li Ming and the rest?
Yeah, that is very likely to happen as well. After all, no one really adds the other ability for Zeratul.
So
Void Prison most likely for Zeratul to go in to stop the tanks and try to take out Li Ming and Malfurion as fast as possible.
Yes.
They also have the firepower of Jaina.
Yes.
To sort of keep Faustet in check with the Blizzard. So
true.
That could help as well.
What happens though? They have the Malfurion on their side of Geisha, so that means a lot of poke coming from Li Ming because of that mana regeneration.
That's
that
right.
Malfurion can give. So
the Innovate will be really useful in helping Li Ming to continue the poke. But Malfurion has the Twilight Dream also. Oh, but let's stop talking. Let's go straight into the game right now.
Yes, sorry. Again, this is the match between Sanctuary versus Geishas. Geishas on the blue side here. Falsad, I am Cure Pro, K1X Pro with a Tyrael, and they're all dancing. How cute of them.
Oh, they're dancing.
Yeah, it's so cute. And Trung on the Li Ming, Diablo, Fiery Boy. How suiting for a name. Malfurion on Freak. There we go.
You guys on TV, you can dance.
Meanwhile, Sanctuary, they on serious business, they're on the gates. Probably wanna...
Going for the waypoints first. It is a huge map, so vision is really going to be very important in this game. Oh, wait, they're missing the waypoint. Okay.
They are probably trying to find a pick. Whoever is roaming around might... get caught out, but they're gonna do a
straight going for
wave.
The tower.
Oh wow!
And Geisha is immediately responding, going to the bottom lane, rotating down. Tyrael at the front line. Tyrael doesn't really have really strong initiation, and here we go, the shadow charge going in as well.
Wow!
Not much casualties there.
Wow! Look at that, taking advantage of the Zarya shield, knowing without low cooldown, they can take on the towers, create pressure so that Geishas will be forced to rotate down below. And Sanctuary gonna be doing the soaking at the moment. Geishas as well, Falstad at the top, so they are forced to go back and soak in their own lanes.
They really have to defend. It's really going to be difficult for them to roam and engage, after all, Li Ming and Falstad.
True.
Are the only damage dealers. Falstad has to keep on his toes and get ready to move anytime here. Right now, all three teams are in each of the lanes trying to soak as well. Being really passive here. Zeratul, we can see he is already going to roam with Varian. Varian really powerful.
Uh-oh.
In the initiation. Here we go, Fiery Boy overpowering there, aiming for the right wing. Right wing is unfortunately going to go down, and that is first blood for Geishas.
Great choice, because Brightwing doesn't have much choices in terms of escaping, because he only has that polymorph and movement speed. So if everybody just tries to rush in, he has no escape whatsoever, especially if there are no teammates nearby. And Daijoubu is going to be Daijoubu. Almost dead.
Daijoubu. Absolutely fine.
There we go. Looks like Snapper is going to be patient with his shield, not being pressured at all by Tyrael jumping onto her.
You wouldn't want to die at this point in time. 2 minutes on the clock. Tribute is coming up really soon. And so try to avoid deaths here. Here we go. Tribute's coming up soon. We do have some interesting roamers going around as well. Uh-huh. Zeratul and Varian and Diablo and Tyrael are roaming around. But here we go. The Tribute at the top lane. Everyone is now converging their Sanctuary now, all together with them, save one Zarya. And Geishas are all converging right now. Will they be able to take them down before the Zarya comes out?
Great call on getting a Merc camp before actually getting the tribute. So that adds more pressure for Sanctuary. Trying to buy them some time. They do have the poking power, but looks like Li Ming might get caught out. He actually teleports away. Fiery Boy, who gets stunned. That's going to be Zeratul, and he will be okay at the moment.
That's right. And right now, Sanctuary putting up a really strong front, giving Jaina the tribute, and the first tribute goes to Sanctuary. A really passive fight there, not much casualties at that team fight, and looks like the tribute is just gonna go to Sanctuary.
Wow, nice play coming from Sanctuary, very patient and trying to zone out the really squishy targets at the moment. Tyriel might be in trouble, but the rest of the members from Geisha are actually collapsing onto the Varian. Ilokai will be safe as two members as well respond to the aggression coming from Geisha's. That is a two-man route from the Malfurion, but no one's gonna fall from that one.
We go! Overpower in, but Zeratul blinks away just in time.
Okay, I thought that was Zeratul. Okay, this might be another kill from K1X, bro. A couple more hits.
Zeratul goes down, unfortunately.
Yeah, the mobility coming from the Tyriel is actually quite difficult to deal with, especially a lot of low targets on the side. Zeratul wasn't able to get away, but just in time, it's going to be the tribute spawning in favor of the side of the Geishas. We'll see how Sanctuary deals with this one. Pretty sure they might want to start collapsing. Tyriel will move and roam towards the top just in case Sanctuary decides to try something funny and delay their take onto that. Diablo zoning them away.
So Diablo zoning them away, and the tribute has already... Tribute almost non-contested. Goes straight to Geisha with the foul stat. They didn't even have a chance, Sanctuary. They couldn't even contest the tribute away. But it's fine. It's one-to-one. Not much difficulties there. Doesn't really cause a lot of problems just yet. Oh, here we go. Freak, unfortunately going for the grenade. Tries to heal himself, but not quite enough. Gets taken out. Ilokai is going in with the charge. Diablo gets taken down. Four members of the team.
2-0 exchange in favor of Sanctuary. They just got caught out of position. They probably just want to try and take a pick, but the damage is just not right there to finish one off and then try to retreat and reposition. So tribute, obviously, on that, I think that's not going to be contested unless Tyriel tries to do something funny. Malfurion will join him shortly. Zarya will create pressure just so that they are not going to be nearby at all. Two now on the side of Sanctuary for the tributes. We'll see.
Looks like Geisha didn't even try to contest for the tribute, which is a good call for them. They were outnumbered because they were out of position. They had two casualties in the team fight just now, therefore costing them the tribute. But it's still okay. 2-1 against them, and this might have been the safer choice. Would have been to not take the tribute and continue going for the mercenary camps, which they do right now.
Great call. Even Sanctuary aiming for the ball. This is like deja vu. But the thing is, it's right. It's deja vu. 2-3 already on the tribute. And what if they do the same thing from the previous match last time where they steamrolled? But the lead is not too much still. They might Geishas will reach level 10 first, but in their favor, tribute spawns nearby. Let's see if they're gonna contest this one, because they're gonna be cursed. Geishas is gonna be cursed.
It was a good gamble. They managed to get the boss just before the tribute spawns. Freak is a bit out of position, has to heal himself right now. Drops the regrowth on himself, and there we go. A bit out of position is Jaina. Jaina will be taken down by the Faustad. Faustad going in at a really, really good time. Disintegrate coming out, but not quite taking anyone out. Zeratul and Brightwing is trying to enclose Falset at the top. Zarya gets taken down. Apocalypse doesn't quite hit anyone. Brightwing still roaming at the top. Varian will be taken down in the process. But look at the boss just pounding on the top lane right now.
Wow. They took a risk, really, because the level 10 spike was about to arrive. They took a lot of time during the boss. Meanwhile, Geishas were soaking on the lane. So once they reached that level 10 spike, they immediately went in with no hesitation at all. But this boss would at least stall them some more so that Sanctuary can regain some composure.
Really really interesting here to see Varian going for the Colossal Smash. We do see a lot of taunts in the previous few games, but Colossal Smash being used here shows that he is going a bit more for the damage as well instead of the taunt. Probably doing so because he has the support of Zarya. Zarya still hasn't really chosen which heroic to go for right now. Most likely Expulsion Zone to try to keep the Geishas away from the tribute.
Yes, so great AoE just in case that they decide to, you know, compress into that single area. You're right, it is going to be a crucial heroic later on. Falstad waiting patiently in the brush. I am pure. Will fly safely, but everybody dives in, uses his heroic.
The mighty gust save him just a bit more time right now.
Yeah, once he saw a lot of people were coming from the mid, no hesitation whatsoever. Use it right away, but the tribute spawns at the top. The pressure is on because both of them are 2-2.
That's right. Brightwing is playing the smart move, not going in as of yet. Geishas have already regrouped. Falstad will be joining in really, really soon. And Li Ming will start the channel a bit. Not quite. Brightwing at really, really low HP right now. Jaina's going in for the Ring of Frost. Captures two of the enemy team heroes. Zeratul goes in with the Gravitron Surge coming in. Takes down Zarya. Zeratul goes down as well. Now Sanctuary's on a retreat right now. Brightwing is really, really low HP. It doesn't really matter. This tribute goes to Geishas. Geishas will successfully curse Sanctuary right now. And he can have the potential to push all this way to this very fort.
Man, that apocalypse from the Diablo was the key for them to actually win that fight. It was the key. And then they got the tribute and now they're steamrolling. Five members still alive, so they can push this really, really hard here at top.
They even overcompensated a bit, and they managed to take down Jaina. A gamble gone well, and now they are at a 3-level EXP lead from Sanctuary. And this, if they can actually steamroll this.
Exactly. This isn't exactly like Deja Vu, but then again, their levels, as you said, is, you know, a bit farther. Diablo actually rushing in, targeting Jaina. But that, because of Zarya's shield, he'll be saved, he'll get stunned, and that'll be the cleanse being popped from the Malfurion. Varian being really brave at the moment will circle around to join his comrades. Interior getting stunned as well. The zoning coming from the Blizzard from Jaina will stop them in their tracks.
Such a wasted VP there. The VP managed to hit four members of Geishas, leaving only Diablo, who was already out of position, but unfortunately, not enough follow-up. And Diablo wasn't able to be taken down, and this gives Geisha half the fort of Sanctuary,
half the keep of Sanctuary. Now they're aiming for the boss, taking all the merc camp that they can. Especially they have the lovely Daijobu and everybody else scouting the area, knowing that the boss is being taken down. They're trying to delay this. No, actually they're not gonna delay it. They're scared. They're gonna back away and prepare to defend.
If they actually went ahead, that would have spelled disaster, because the entire team for Geishas will be able to take them out with relative ease, and that would have been disaster. But nonetheless, they got the boss. Sanctuary managed to get the siege camp to try to defend against the boss. Good call there, to do so. And now will be a clash at the bottom lane.
Definitely, they're gonna be playing the defense game at the moment. Sanctuary is gonna be pretty worried, as 15-13, almost 16 as well, on their levels for Geishas. And at the moment, they're trying to do they have a good clear with the Jaina, but the problem is, the levels is just problematic.
Yes. One additional talent, level 16 is really difficult. Here comes the apocalypse there, and we have the VP managing to stun so many of the team. That's like four right now.
Whoa.
And here we go, the disintegrate comes in with the Ring of Frost there. The sanctification doesn't quite stop the onslaught there.
Wow, that was a huge void prison, but then again, there were a lot of people caught up on that one. Sanctification has been used as well. Look at them destroying the core slowly but surely. And one only hero being able to defend. Actually not able to defend.
One team fight, and that was all Geishas need to go straight for the core, and game one goes to Geishas.
Wow. It was pretty even. Congratulations again to Sanctuary for winning that match against Geishas, but I think what happened there was that it was pretty even at first, right?
It was pretty even, you're
but
right.
But then they were attacking the boss. They took a long time. The rest of the members from Sanctuary, correct?
That's right. Sanctuary. Is it which side? The right side?
Oh, no, the left.
Geishas.
Geishas. Okay, yep. Sorry, my bad. Geishas were soaking experience. They reached that level 10 spike. They started a fight, and then they got the curse for themselves.
That's right. It was pretty even, like you mentioned, but the steamroll happened when the first EXP lead was there, and then after that, they were like three levels ahead. Sanctuary couldn't even catch up to them, and they lost out in the talent tier, and they lost the game because of that. The last gamble was really the last fight where they had a boss, they had the siege giants, they had all their ultimates ready, but unfortunately the ultimates, the heroics for Geisha's side was too powerful. The VP was good, but no, the VP I believe captured four. Yeah. I didn't. It was happening a bit too fast.
Yeah.
I think he captured four. They didn't take the one guy down too quickly. The boss was dealing too much damage. Yes. And yeah.
And there was also a fight near the tribute near the Geisha's base.
That's right.
Where the Jaina was caught out right away. So that's one less DPS for the side of Sanctuary.
Okay.
And then after that, Falstad actually tried to attack from behind. Probably tried to create some chaos, but due to Diablo's apocalypse, I think there were like three people being stunned there, and they had, you know, nothing to reply. They had no response to that. So yeah, GGWP for the side of
Geishas. Yes, Geishas. That's right. So congratulations, Geishas, for taking game one. The second map will be the battlefield of eternity.
With the immortals.
That's right. Interesting fact, though, you guys don't really see the map draft, but when we do actually start banning the maps, the first few maps, you wouldn't guess it. It's always Braxis and Warhead Junction.
Nobody wants that.
Nobody wants Braxis and Warhead Junction. So yeah, just interesting fact. If you think you know why this maps are always being banned, you just go leave it ahead in the chat.
Yes, sorry. And
but anyway, Battlefield of Eternity, the next map. So what do you know about this map?
Well, for starters, you would really... I feel like maybe Malfurion would be a contested pick, because you'd stay a long time trying to destroy the Immortal or trying to bother your opponents while they're destroying your own Immortal.
That's right.
So I feel like maybe they could contest that. Maybe we might see an ETC. Mm-hmm. ETC Diablo again. Diablo could actually be used again, because we saw how Geishas can use the apocalypse very, very effectively.
That's right.
So that's pretty scary if everybody's clumped up in that one area for a long time.
That's right.
So if they get zoned out, get poked out, maybe another Li Ming. This is definitely their style. It's quite a similar concept, but this is longer this time around. So probably more damage just so that they can melt through the Immortal as fast as they can, probably even faster, or maybe try to make a pick first before they can actually engage onto the enemy Immortal. But yeah, let's see how this pans out.
That's right. So another key for Battlefield of Eternity, like you mentioned, the sustain from Malfurion, the AoE from Diablo.
Yes.
You might also want to choose assassins as well. Assassins that can take out the Immortal. So most team compositions that especially come from the North America, the scene, they center the teams around two types of teams. They have one team that either focuses down the Immortals as fast as possible, or one that goes and tries to destroy the enemy team first, then they go for the Immortal, because they know where the enemy team is anyway. Yep. They will be at the Immortals, and therefore it is easy to find out where they are.
That is correct.
So yesterday we've actually seen a Chen being played in the Battlefield of Eternity.
Okay. Yeah.
In the NA scene, there was a Tyrande for the Hunter's Mark. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Yeah.
So that was the time when Chen was being played. There was that was the gray main, right? With the team with the gray main.
I think so. Yeah.
He wanted to escape, and then the Chen was drinking and got body blocked.
Yes.
Yeah, I remember that.
Panda user was really, he was really amused by that. He kept laughing all the way.
It was an interesting scene. Got body blocked. But anyway, we'll see how this pans out. Because if you look at Geisha's playing style, it seems like it fits them very well if they apply it at the same tactics for Battlefield of Eternity. So meanwhile, what do you think could have gone better for the side of Sanctuary? Because they were doing really well.
They were doing well. Well, let me think. What were the heroes again?
Jaina.
Jaina.
Zeratul.
Zeratul could have done... Okay, Zeratul's VP. Some of them were on point. He had one VP that could have changed the game, and that was when he captured the four teammates and separated Diablo. And the entire team of Sanctuary was there, but they weren't able to focus down the Diablo down
fast enough.
And unfortunately, they couldn't get the momentum swing back into their favor.
True.
And they might have... You can even debate and say that they lost from there. Yeah, so...
I think that was the time they... Geishas was already level 16, and then 13 was the level of Sanctuary.
Sanctuary.
So it was quite difficult to, you know, focus a target down at that time. Although, they... I think it went all wrong during the experience spike when they took so long on the boss, perhaps?
They took so long on the boss on what, Sanctuary side?
Sanctuary side, they took too long in taking the boss, and then when they weren't mm-hmm. level 10 just yet, and then when Geisha spotted them out, they reached that level 10, then bam.
Oh, I see.
They didn't
That could have happened as well. So a few things that could have definitely been improved on for Sanctuary side. But no worries, this is a best out of three
game.
Yeah,
true.
Best out
they
of three
still
game.
Have another chance.
And I think we can both agree that it wasn't like a steamroll game.
It wasn't
one-sided. It was good until in the middle part where Geishas actually got the upper hand.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Things weren't going so well. For example, there were team fights that, you know, Jaina was got picked off.
That's right.
Right away. So, yeah, one less damage dealer for their side.
And as I've been talking about in the streams, I've never really liked Jaina as the ranged assassin. she needs a little bit of work. In the end, better ranged assassins have always been Li Ming and Vala. Really powerful
heroes.
You're
actually expecting a Vala pick.
Yeah, I was expecting a Vala pick, but unfortunately Jaina came out, which was pretty weird given that you didn't need the AoE. The Jaina didn't perform as that well as well.
Yes.
Yeah, so unfortunately. But can't really blame them as well because Li Ming was picked on Geisha's side.
Yes, yes.
So Sanctuary didn't really have much to work with.
Yeah, and they had really good sets. Props to Geisha. Really catching off Sanctuary off guard every time they do a clash or, you know, try to poke them out during the objective. So it was pretty hard to deal with.
That's right, unfortunately. So they are still in the midst of the drafting of the map.
Yes.
Wow.
So anyway, what else would you recommend for, you know, Battlefield of Eternity aside from, you know, long sustained team fights, long sustained pokes and all that?
Well, like I mentioned, you still need someone who can take down Immortals as fast as possible.
Yeah.
Or stop the opponent from taking down the Immortals. After all, Battlefield of Eternity is a two-lane map, and yes, there won't be a lot of laning here.
True.
So you definitely wouldn't want to go globals here for starters. Aren't really important compared to Cursed Hollow. Okay, and the game has started. Let's go straight to the draft.
Alrighty, let's see if, you know, Sanctuary can get this to a 1-1 so that we'll see a map 3, or is this going to be a 2-0 by Geishas?
Yep, and Sanctuary has to fight harder for this.
That is true. And you know what? The typical bans, you know, we might not see in our Tannis in this game because they normally ban that, but
ETC?
They could ban ETC. Ragnaros, very typical.
Ragnaros, Atanas, they might go for the Ragnaros here. Ragnaros was banned in the previous game.
Yes.
And Ragnaros would be really useful in defending against the Immortal and also to push the lanes if needed.
Yes, Malfurion definitely is going to be a priority for the healer.
Oh, excuse you.
Excuse me.
Nice, Malfurion. So.
Oh, wow, they don't want to see the Malfurion. Excusez-moi, this time around. So, Rengar is a nice choice for another healer on their side.
Yep.
Also, Auriel as well. You
really
need
yay.
Mana, and you would get consistent damage since the Immortal is going to be there. So, you'll have your energy being recharged every time.
And most importantly, Riku wants to see your play.
It's not obvious that Auriel's my favorite. All right.
Okay, Artanis has been picked, a really powerful tank. But we've seen in the previous few games that Artanis won't generally always be the only tank.
Yes.
Geishas would likely to go for another tank. Artanis, after all, can deal a lot of damage when it comes to team fights with the Phase, Frism, and the Blade Dash. So let's see what Geisha goes for.
Yeah,
two picks on the side of Sanctuary.
We'll see though, because they might want to secure either a healer, because I'm not sure. If they give the second phase of picking...
Ragnaros.
Oh, right. Ragnaros. You know what? Never mind. Ragnaros was open.
Ragnaros was open. Going for two really powerful assassins here. Ragnaros and Vala. And so they have Geishas have to come up with a counter to these two really powerful assassins.
Yeah, that's actually pretty smart of them to actually take all the really good damage dealer, especially Vala. When, like, you know, especially Ragnaros, it's finally open. Yeah, let's take it. I believe you called him broken.
Yeah.
yesterday, and also Vala with that really good utility on the stun, linear stun. Especially, it's so easy to land that when they're all clamped up. But good response to this, Li Ming.
That's right, Li Ming, really powerful range assassin, and of course the second support, Rhaegar coming up. So now the first ban, they have actually all three really powerful heroes on the side of Geisha. It would be a bit difficult to ban. They could ban another assassin that they are afraid of, or they could ban the tank. I believe they won't be touching supports as of now. Atanas will be pretty powerful when it comes together with another tank. They might ban the Diablo
here. Yeah, especially ETC is off the table. There's not much options. Maybe we might see another Dehaka, not because of his global, but due to the fact that his sustain is incredibly enormous.
Yep.
Yeah, and the pick potential as well, because Artanis can do that. Maybe on Sanctuary side, they would want that for themselves later if they go onto the picking. What I like about this regular pick is that once you land in a totem, not much options now on their side. Yes. I like this pick. Once a totem will fall with a slow and everything, Li Ming would be able to easily land all those shots when she lands in the poke during the battle phase of the Immortals.
Right now, Geishas can ban a tank or support, but they do ban Johanna here.
All the tanks have been taken out.
It'd be interesting to see what tank Sanctuary goes for.
Alright, I wonder what else they could go for tanks. And you know,
maybe we might see Arthas.
Arthas, Dehaka, the popular
Dehaka
picks. Let's see what else. You know, they've been banning a lot of tanks.
They still have Chen up for grabs. Chen, Dehaka, Muradin, a really powerful tank as well. Especially in this game, really powerful CC can peel off an enemy team, but they don't really have any strong frontliners. So Muradin's. Yeah. Muradin might be a bit questionable here.
True. Maybe Varian. Varian is still open.
Varian is open as well. Varian.
Going the tank build as well. So, I'm not sure if Chen will be picked, even though he was picked yesterday.
Yesterday.
Yeah, so we'll see though.
They do have to choose a support right now.
Uther.
Uther as a support. We've not seen this for some time. Uther and Arthas.
The reaction of the people here.
Wow, Uther and Arthas. This is like Warcraft all over again.
Yeah.
The mentor and the trainee. Uther and Arthas, definitely one of the old meta. It doesn't even seem like I'm looking at the new meta right now.
Oh, man.
If you get rid of Ragnaros, it looks like Sanctuary is playing a game of the old meta.
Exactly. And can imagine the slow potential of what the Arthas could do revolving around... the objective as well. So, two melee on the side.
Well,
of
I caught
Geishas.
The Arthas.
yeah, you did. Yes, you did. Congratulations. Did not see the Uther coming though.
Okay. Muradin definitely a very viable tank.
Yeah.
Especially coupled with Artanis. And one more assassin on the team.
Melee festival.
Might be Thrall. Oh, Sylvanas. Sylvanas is good as well. Nice skin.
What a cute skin.
Yeah. Sylvanas. Okay.
So lots of damage coming from and sieging as well from the side of Sylvanas. Of Geishas, rather. Especially if they do get the Immortals on their side. They would really melt down the minions and the structures once they get that upper hand in securing the Immortals. So... really scary if you give that to them.
So right now, Sanctuary has the power when it comes to Vala and Ragnaros, but they might not be able to not necessarily able to take down Immortals faster than Geishas. Geishas' abilities to firepower comes from Li Ming and Sylvanas. Mm-hmm. They have and Artanis as well. He can deal a lot of damage. So the last pick will be really interesting. They could go for another assassin or another support. Dual tank setup hasn't been doing really well. Raynor. What meta? What meta is this?
Oh my, okay.
Wow.
Alright. Okay. What are they planning?
Okay, Raynor, I can understand. Raynor, as we mentioned, they need his firepower to take the Immortals down. Mm-hmm. He has a lot of damage when it comes to the AA. I bet Geishas is just like blown out of their minds.
What is this? What is happening? Exactly. So Raynor really good sustain as well on his E.
Sorry, what?
E. Right?
Oh yeah, adrenaline rush.
Yes,
right.
Adrenaline
so
rush.
So Raynor has this self-sustain. Doesn't need Uther's healing. Uther, if you notice, has fell off a bit in the competitive scene. Because his heal has just lost out to the likes of Malfurion and Rhaegar.
But due to the fact that it has been banned.
That's right. Oh, although really interesting why you pick Uther over the likes of like Ariel or Brightwing. There were so many there. or Tessera. But they picked Uther. I think they have something up their sleeves here.
Yeah.
We have to see. They do have the Howling Blast plus Raynor's auto attack. So that might be useful
That is
as
true.
Well.
The... attack speed buff coming from the Raynor as well.
That's right.
So it will mesh out properly when they fight the Immortal or trying to defend against the Immortal.
That's right.
So it's very quite
sensible. So it looks like Sanctuary is going for the side that goes for the going for the build that takes the Immortals down as fast as possible and then get out of there as fast as possible as well.
True.
And then Geishas is just there to try to contest them. We have powerful CC when it comes to Muradin. And Artanis, obviously, the Blade Dash plus Phase Prism combination can take down the likes of Raynor and Vala quickly. So it has to see, maybe Ragnaros might be the turning point here, you never know.
Yeah, especially on defense.
Oh, and Raynor is going for the slightly defensive build as well. Not really going for the seasoned marksman. And we have a pause here.
Yes, just a slight pause, guys. So you were saying about the Raynor?
That's right, he is going for the Give Me More, increasing Adrenaline Rush instead of the Seasoned Marksman. Seasoned Marksman, generally a huge pick. We were talking saying that Raynor could be used to take the Immortals down. And it might make a big of sense in choosing Seasoned Marksman. Most players as well go for the Seasoned Marksman. So to go for Give Me More, really interesting. He's going for the self-sustain build.
So more safety on his side, just so that in case he gets picked off, then... the burst damage, burst heal.
That's right.
So,
and I haven't really seen the other talents of the other heroes, but it does make a bit of sense here. Uther's healing pales in comparison to Malfurion and Rhaegar. And we have really powerful heroes in the forms of Li Ming and Sylvanas on the other side. And having Adrenaline Rush might get out of, for example, Muradin CC gives Raynor the edge.
Yeah,
to, like,
more survivability on this side of Raynor. That's why, you know, he didn't choose the seasoned marksman talent. We'll see how that fares out. So maybe they just want to last as long as they can when the Immortals are up.
Maybe that's
their plan.
We could see that. So looks like they have some technical difficulties here.
Yeah, but you know what? We're here for you.
Yeah, we're here for
you. Gonna talk to you guys.
okay, we were talking about... Anyway, happy Lunar New Year,
Yay!
Everyone. Yay!
And just as a reminder earlier from Teddy, you guys should finish the rooster...
That's right, the rooster race. Not from Yankee, from Panda User.
Oh, from Panda.
That's right. Rooster race. Go and finish up the quest. You get a cool rooster mount that you can...
I finished it already!
Oh, no. That's right. Rooster mount is really cute. And
it
also,
is, it is.
Yeah.
Very festive.
And we have a lot of new skins. That's right. Samuro and Li Ming. Really cute. Samuro's skin is really interesting in this case. The Monkey King skin.
It suits him well, I suppose.
Yeah, there's no other hero that... that could suit this skin really well.
The monkey vibe.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is true.
Okay. So, all right. game has been back. Let's head on back down here. And here we go. Arthas is, of course, the main tank right now. He will be in front. Not much happening here. They're just staying together.
Probably.
Not
just
going
scouting?
Out of position. Yeah.
Yes.
Just scouting there. We have Geishas lying in wait for anyone who come out of position at the bottom.
That is true.
And okay, we have Ronaldo keeps his spawn. They have gone to the individual lanes. Ragnaros and Reyna at the top lane together with Artanis. And we have the Arthas, Uther. Who else is there? Vala at the bottom lane with four of Geishas' team. Pretty typical composition. Four men at the bottom lane. One man at the top to soak the lane.
Yes, looks like it's going to be a Ragnaros and then Artanis matchup here. I guess no pick will happen so far, especially with the Fiery Boy going to hide over there. But here, we're going to see a party. Who gets through the freak? Is in trouble. Rengar is going to run away from danger, but Daijobu is pretty low at the moment. But due to the heal, he will be safe for now.
Arthur's going for the Eternal Hunger talent instead of the Block talent. Not really focusing on the tank ability. He's going for the mana to deal as much damage as he can with his trait. A really interesting thing happening here.
So with Raynor actually aiming for the more sustain, even even Arthas as well. So they're really hoping to last as long as they can compared to what the Geishas can handle. Because Geisha has a lot of poke, has a lot of range, but they do have some melee just to get bothered by the Arthas when he comes close. But I am Cure, really brave at this point, trying to distract them.
So right now, both teams going for both of their Immortals, but we all know that the blue team actually has the greater firepower. They have the Reyna and the Vala. Geisha should be focusing on what they're strong at, and that is to destroy the enemy team first before actually going for the Immortal.
Man, look at how fast the Immortal is melting. Coming from the side of Sanctuary, Geishas are doing a really good job. They'll be the first one to get their Immortal
their
side.
So, Geishas, in the end, contrary to what I said, they had the stronger firepower despite Reyna and Vala on the side of Sanctuary. They will be able to capture their Immortals here. Liming and Sylvanas and Artana showing how powerful their auto attack can be despite what I've said. So they will be able to capture the Immortals. Immortals will be pushing at the top lane. Muradin and Vala going to the bottom lane for more soak, and it's up to how Sanctuary can defend against this. Molten Core comes in with the Lava Wave there coming in to try to push everyone back. Ragnaros showing how powerful he can be at defending the structure.
Nice zone coming from Arthas onto Artanis and the rest of the members, but they still have to deal with the poke, with the ranged damage dealers from the side of Geishas, and they're doing a pretty good job and repositioning themselves. That is a three-man route, but they'll be A-OK. The Immortal is slowly dying out. I wonder if they'll be able to eliminate this structure.
Managed to get the Immortals down before the fort goes down. So good defense by Sanctuary. Not much EXP gap there as well. So good place.
Yeah, Geisha's. You're right. They're still quite even on the experience. Geisha's not gonna leave that top side. Will get the Merc camp at the top as well to create more and continue pressure. Since it is just the fort that there's no walls, there's no towers that are left. They can still continue on with that siege.
Mercenary camps going for both sides of Sanctuary and Geishas, and they will be at the top lane right now. Top lane a bit outnumbered in the sense Sanctuary has to keep on their toes. A Phase Prison goes down, that can spell disaster for both teams. And here we go, a good route but no follow up from the side of Sanctuary.
Nah.
Vala and Muradin still at the bottom lane. Really strong firepower coming from Vala, and it is not here to assist Sanctuary there. Muradin is still okay. We're seeing that Artanis can still act as a tank to try to do the peels off. Oh, and here we go. Both teams going down for Vala. Vala will be taken down from a Stormbolt from I Am Pure.
Wow, look at that rotations coming from Geisha. Not hesitating at all. Sanctuary was a tad bit too late to save the Vala from that collapse from Geisha. And now they're knocking on the door here at the bottom side of the map. Stunned for I Am Pure, but he'll just get healed perfectly by the Rengar. He's quite low. He might just try to retreat, but towers are slowly falling on Sanctuary.
All right, Immortal spawning in the next 15 seconds. They have to contest for this. Geishas have shown that they have the potential to take the Immortals down much faster than Sanctuary. So
yes.
This means that Sanctuary needs to actually contest for the Immortals, that Red Immortal, Geisha's Immortals at the top, while Sanctuary's Immortals at the bottom there. We have the team of Geisha is going down to the bottom with Artanis defending the Immortal at the top. The clash happening at below right now. Arthas is going in straight for Pro, but doesn't quite take him out. IMQ a bit out of position there. Uta is going straight for him as well. Four of the team heroes of Geisha is coming. Uta is coming straight back in from the middle, but focus fired by Vala. Not quite enough to take him out. Uta really being a very hardy hero in this case.
Man, look at that. Sanctuary switching strategies right away. Instead, they're going to be defending, just as you have mentioned earlier. And Totem being brought down, that will go down as well. There's the slow from earlier, but look, Artanis is actually looking for a pick. Actually, just trying to keep zoning them so that they would hesitate in actually get engaging on the side against Geishas. But at this point, though, it's quite difficult.
IMQR really doing a really good job in just being an annoying pest there. Yeah. And then we can see at the top lane as well, the mercenary camps moving in. Good call by Geisha to actually go for the mercenary camps to push on the top lane. Vala unfortunately taken down. That's a lot of firepower taken out. Only Reyna is now supplying the firepower together with Ragnaros. Ragnaros still a bit of a... Arthas gets taken down in the process.
Wow, that is such a smart call from Geisha. You're right. They secured a camp so that Ragnaros was forced to go back. It was a 4v5. Someone got picked off from Sanctuary. And that was another opportunity for Geishas to keep concentrating, focusing the Immortal down of Sanctuary. And then again, second Immortal on their side. Justin Sudo is going to get stunned. Reynar go bye-bye. And that is them knocking on the door of Sanctuary here at bot.
And here we go. While they were knocking on the door, they managed to capture the Immortals, and the level 10 talents have become Suppression Pulse and Ancestral Healing from the side of Geisha's Avatar. On Avatar and the Teleport and the Wailing Arrows on the side of Geisha's. Sanctuary at level 8, two levels disadvantage compared to Geisha's now, and they will find it's really difficult right now to actually defend against Geisha's.
Definitely very, very problematic at the moment. Level 11 to level 8, still no level 10 power spike. I am here in the middle of it all, but he gets healed down. Blue team hero killed. Two more fall down on their side. Ragnaros is running for his life. He's pretty low at the moment, but still getting hit. Will get some sustain from the well, but everybody else from Geishas are still very much healthy. And it's just Mirrodin running out of mana, actually, but that's fine. They're okay. They're very, very determined to finish this off in this push.
This is the steamroll that we're looking at. The Immortal still with the shields up, with the range now going straight for the core. We have IMQ at the bottom trying to go for Snapper. Snapper doesn't quite get taken down. Uta saves him just a little bit. But we have Ragnaros going on Molten Core at the bottom as well. I'm got taken down. Arthas is taken down, unfortunately, followed by Vala. Li Ming doing so much damage to Vala. Suppression Pulse comes in, blinds Reyna. Reyna won't be even able to take anyone down. I'm got second win activated in, pushing Teddy away from the fort. And here we go.
Wow.
Game 2 goes to Geishas. And congratulations, Geishas, for moving on to the next round.
My god, that was just a very, very fast match. Two Immortals being taken down on the side of Geishas. They, even though Sanctuary switched up their strategy, maybe try to defend their Immortal first, try to find maybe Geishas will make a mistake somehow, but because of the pressure in the top lane, you know what? This is taking too long! Our top is getting pressured so much! So Ragnaros was forced to go up, and then bam, you know, it's a 4v5, let's do this.
Yeah, all meta heroes, that's all it is. Reyna,
yeah.
Arthas, and Uther, there is a reason why they don't see play. They're generally always outclassed by the better tanks and the better supports out there. Arthas could have easily been outclassed. What did we say? Could have been outclassed by...
Yes.
By someone. Muradin.
Muradin.
They could have picked Muradin, but they chose Arthas instead, giving what's this, Geishas Muradin.
Yeah.
That was unfortunate. And Reyna as well, instead of characters like Jaina or Kalthas.
Yeah.
They chose Reyna for the auto attack. Not quite enough to take anyone down. If Arthas went for the suppression pulse, which he did, Reyna wouldn't have been able to deal the damage that he needed to do.
That is true. I don't know, man. That was really, really impressive coming from Geishas. They really know what to do whenever Sanctuary decides to, you know, change something up on their strategy. But yeah, there you have it.
Yeah, congratulations, Geishas, for moving on to the next round. So this is Vietnam moving on to the next round. They are pretty new in the scene, and congratulations moving on.
Yes, congratulations to our day one and day two players. And the upcoming matches will be next weekend at February 11. And there is our scheduled Inquisition, Arcadia, Renovatio, and Geishas. Actually, they're the ones that are gonna be facing
Renovatio
and Geishas.
Wow, a strong match right off the start. Renovatio, the top team for the Philippines, going to BlizzCon 2016, and they'll be going against Geishas. Geishas, you gotta get your guns prepared, man.
Exactly. And so many good matches actually this week. Peiji and the gang, we saw how really good they are, but of course, Resurgence as well. A very much, you know, favorite in the C scene as well.
Of course, and Mailbox, team to actually take Renovatio down, will be going against Deadly Kittens. In case you forgot, Deadly Kittens has Ziz and Merl, basically two players in the old Renovatio team that actually went to BlizzCon. So a lot of action packed for you next
week.
Yes,
so if you guys want to know the latest schedules, don't forget to like the Heroes of the Storm C Facebook page. Just search it up and then you'll find it. Like it so you get the latest updates on the schedule. So again, thank you so much for watching. I am Riku.
And my name is Teddy Pei.
I'll see you guys next weekend.